them, eyelid and eyelid disorder. To start with, just a brief, let's say, description of the anatomy of the eyelids. If we can, let's say, divide the eyelid into anterior lamella and the posterior lamella and the lid margin. The anterior lamella mainly composed of the anterior layer of the skin and the palpebral part of the orbicularis muscle. The posterior lamella composed mainly of the collagenous layer or the tarsal plate and the tarsal conduit fiber or the epithelial lining, which align the internal part of the eyelids, which is the tarsal conduit fiber. The lid margin also, we can divide it into anterior and posterior lamella, where we can find the hair follicles of the lashes aligned in the anterior lamella or in the anterior margin, anterior part of the lid margin, and the orifices of the meibomian glands lined on the posterior part of the lid margin. Again, here just what you have to know about the major component of the eyelid. So this is the skin here, coming from the outside, as I said, and then the orbicularis muscle, and both of them, they are, let's say, form the anterior lamella. And going back to the posterior lamella, this is the tarsal plate, and we can see the meibomian gland within the tarsal plate, and this is the conjunctiva, which line the tarsal conjunctiva, which line the inter part of them with the eyelids. Again, there's usually a gray line on the lid margin, so you can clearly differentiate between the anterior lamella and the posterior lamella of the eyelid. Meibomian gland, it's the main, let's say, glands that secrete the oily layer of the tear film. And we say before, we are going to talk about the eyelid, let's say, problems. So you have to know the very important muscles here, which is the levator muscle, and this is the aponeurosis of the levator muscle, and then the molar muscle, which is a sympathetically innervated muscle. So both of them responsible for the elevation and the normal position of the upper eyelid, and both of them could be involved in the drooping of the upper eyelid or the ptosis. This is just a picture, as I said, of the anatomy of the eye and the medial, let's say, canthus, the lateral angle or the lateral canthus, and both upper and lower eyelid and the normal direction of the lashes. This is just anatomy of the lacrimal drainage system, and you have to know that there is the upper and the lower puncti and the superior or inferior canaliculi, then the common canaliculus, the nasolacrimal sac or the lacrimal sac, and then the nasolacrimal duct. There are two very important valves, which is the valve of Hasner at the end of the nasolacrimal duct in the inferior meatus, and also the valve of Rosenmüller, which is the junction between the common canaliculus and the lacrimal sac. In general, what are the functions of the eyelids? The eyelid, as you can see, is to provide the physical protection of the whole globe. It can also participate in the tear surfacing. So to see a clear image, you need a very smooth tear film and very smooth surface. And as you know, the most important refractive surface in the eye, it is the air tear interface, which is the let's say the anterior part of the, let's say, the eye on the cornea. And again, it also can participate in the drainage of the tears. What are the, let's say, general parts or disorders that can affect the eyelids? It could affect them abnormal lid position, or it can be some sort of inflammation within the eyelid, or some sort of masses, lumps, and also we'll speak about them eyelash abnormalities. Lid position abnormality could be either ptosis or entropion or ectropion. These are the three main, let's say, disorders of the lid position. What is the ptosis? It's abnormally low position of the upper eyelid usually. It could be congenital or acquired. Normally, as we all know, the upper eyelid usually cover 1 to 2 millimeters of the upper part of the cornea, whereas the lower eyelid usually line with the limbus, and this is the normal position. So here in ptosis, we'll see abnormal low position of the upper eyelid. Underlying causes or the pathogenesis could be aponeurotic, which is the disinsertion of the aponeurosis of the levator muscle. And this is usually, we call it age-related or senile ptosis. Other cause could be mechanical due to any lump or mass that cause mechanical drooping of the upper eyelid. Neurological causes could be due to the ternary palsy or Horner syndrome, and myogenic due to abnormal muscle function, which could be myasthenia gravis, myotonic dystrophy, progressive external ophthalmic lesion. This is two pictures of ptosis, and we can see here in the picture to the left, there is a clear asymmetry between the position of the right upper eyelid and the left upper eyelid. And if you can see the light reflex on the cornea here and there, this is the reflex that we usually use to measure the MRD1 and MRD2. MRD1, which is the margin reflex distance, I mean the distance between the corneal light reflex and the upper eyelid margin. This is the MRD1, which is usually around 4 millimeters, and clearly it appears here it's almost less than 1 millimeter. So this is a right ptosis. On the left side also we can see a child with again a right ptosis, and you can see the difference, as I said, between the MRD1 in the left eye compared with the MRD1 in the right eye. The MRD2 is the difference between, or the distance between, the corneal reflex and the lower lid margin, okay, which is here almost symmetrical in both eyes. So if we are going to talk about mechanical causes of ptosis, this could be due to a large lid lesions pulling down the eyelid, could be due to a lid edema or tethering of the lid by conjunctival scarring, which is the cicatricial causes. Neurological causes of ptosis, as we said before, it could be the ternary palsy or Horner syndrome due to sympathetic nerve lesion. And in Horner syndrome, we will see just a very mild ptosis due to the affection of the molar muscle, which is responsible for about 2 millimeters of the elevation of the upper eyelid. And the third cause of the neurological cause of ptosis could be the Marcus Gandjo-Wilkins syndrome. This is a congenital problem where there is a miswiring of the nerve supply to the pterygoid muscle of the jaw and the levator muscle of the eyelid. So there is a miswiring between the trigeminal nerve and the oculomotor nerve, so that the eyelid moves in conjunction with the chewing movements or the movement of the pterygoid muscle. Myogenic causes of ptosis, we mentioned that before, it could be myasthenia gravis, some sort of muscular dystrophy like myotonic dystrophy, or chronic progressive external ophthalmoplegia. Symptoms, the most common symptom is just the drooping of the upper eyelid and the cosmetic appearance of the patient or the child. Okay, sometimes it can affect the vision. Is severe ptosis and covering the pupillary area and the visual axis, it could block the vision and affect the vision. And sometimes can cause some sort of astigmatism. This droopy eyelid can cause some sort of astigmatism and blurry vision. In addition to the associated symptoms of the primary or the underlying cause, like diplopia, reduced eye movement, and anisocoria, which is the unequal size of the pupil. Signs with ptosis, as I said, there will be a abnormal, let's say, lower position of the upper eyelid, so the palpebral fissure will be narrow compared with the other eye if it is unilateral. The normal palpebral fissure differ from the, let's say, male and female patients, so the range is around 10 millimeter, maybe 8 to 10 millimeter. This is the average palpebral fissure. definitely abnormal low position of the upper eyelid, and we say that it usually covers the upper 1 to 2 millimeter of the cornea. This is the normal position, but in ptosis it will be covering more than 2 millimeter of the upper part of the cornea. Again, could we have a decrease in the function of the levator muscle, which is goes with myogenic or neurogenic causes, and also fatigability in myasthenia gravis. If we suspect ptosis due to the myasthenia gravis, we should observe the ptosis after repeated eyelid movement up and down. So increasing the ptosis after this repeatable movement is suggestive of the fatigability, or it's suggestive of myasthenia gravis. And definitely you have to look for them other signs of the Horner syndrome and the third nerve pulse. Management in general, okay, depend, first of all, you have to rule underlying causes. So sometimes, like myasthenia gravis, could be treated medically, okay, but in general, ptosis would require a surgical correction. And there is many, let's say, approach to correct the upper eyelid ptosis, and the our choice of the treatment will depend on the function of the levator muscle and the degree of the ptosis. So we start with the levator resection, and also we can, let's say, treat that with frontalis suspension in severe myogenic and poor levator function. Talking about intraocular, this is the interning of the lower lid margin toward the eye. It may occur if the patient looks downward, or maybe induced by a forced lid closure. Most commonly seen in elderly patients, which is the senile or the involutional, let's say, type of intraocular, where the occipital muscle becomes weakened, but also it can cause by the conjunctival scarring or cicatricial conjunctivitis, which can be a part of the Steven Johnson syndrome, ocular cicatricial pemphigoid, chemical injury. And the problem here that the intern of the lower lid margin, or the margin, it will also intern the lashes toward the cornea, and this will cause a chronic and continuous irritation of the eye, and it may cause also abrasion of the cornea and even scar and ulcer or even perforation. Short-term treatment of this problem, we suspect this is a temporary problem and couldn't resolve, okay, could be just by them taping the lid away from the eyeball to keep the lashes away from the cornea, and application of lubricants to soothe the eye. But definitely, let's say the permanent treatment will require surgical correction of the lower eyelid intraocular. This is the lower eyelid intraocular, and it's clear there that you can see the lid margin, the whole lid margin, inverts toward the eye, toward the globe, and you can see the, and you can see the lash is abnormal directly toward the cornea and touching the ocular surface. Intraocular, it is the opposite, it is the inversion of the eyelid margin outward, away from the globe. And again, the causes could be just involutional or age related, due to the orbicularis laxity. It could be due to the cicatricial causes, so the periorbital skin scarring or cicatricial changes can cause or pull the lid margin away from the globe. Facial nerve palsy, which is the paralytic type of the ectropion. And again, the mechanical causes due to any, let's say, masses or lesions. Complication from ectropion, if you can imagine, as I said, the function of the lid, it's the surface of the tear film. It's also the drainage of the eyelid, the drainage of the tear, let's say, from the eye. So definitely the complication will be epiphora because of this outward inversion or outward turning of the lid margin. It will take away the, let's say, fungi, which is part of the lacrimal drain system, away from the ocular surface, and this will definitely decrease the normal tear drainage, and patient will start complaining of water eye, which is the epiphora. Also, it can cause eye irritation and corneal exposure. Treatment again according to the cause, but mostly again we need surgical correction with tightening of the lid if it is due to involutional cicatricial causes or mechanical causes, need also surgical treatment. And this is just a picture of the ectropion for lower eyelid, and you can see here the abnormal position where you can see the either the palpebral conjunctival appear here, and the whole lid margin is outward, turning away from the globe. And definitely, if you can imagine, so the puncta here will be abnormally inverted away from the ocular surface. So talking about the inflammation of the eyelids, which is the main problem, and it's a very common and chronic problem, which is the blepharitis. It's a very common, as I said, chronic eyelid inflammation. It could be anterior blepharitis, so it's mainly affecting the anterior lamella and the lash, let's say, line. So it's concentrated anterior along the lash line of the lid margin, accompanied by squamous depress, staphylococcal overgrowth, and in some small infiltrates or ulcers at the peripheral cornea, which is the marginal keratitis. Anterior blepharitis, this is mainly a meibomian gland dysfunction, so it's affecting the posterior part of the lid margin and related to the terminal ducts of the meibomian gland, where it's usually obstructed by squamous depress and the lipid products of the glands. Symptoms of both, and it's common to see a mixed anterior posterior blepharitis in clinical practice. So the symptoms that the patient usually come with, it's usually tiredness, itchy, sore eye, mainly in the morning, and thrusting of the lid margin in anterior blepharitis, mainly redness on both anterior posterior blepharitis, redness of the lid margin, I mean, and tearing, of course, could be symptoms in both anterior and posterior blepharitis. Signs, again, it depends if it is mainly anterior or posterior. As I say, it's common to see a mixed anterior and posterior inflammation or blepharitis at the same time. So signs could be scaling of the lid margin, inflammation of the lash follicles, decreased number of the lashes, which is mainly with the anterior part, with the anterior blepharitis, a plugging of meibomian gland ducts, and foamy tear film and tear film abnormality. These are mainly with the posterior type of the blepharitis. And in severe cases, as I said, blepharokerato or blepharokeratitis and marginal keratitis could be some signs with the severe blepharitis. Conjunctival injection also, this is an associated sign. This is just a few, let's say, signs of the blepharitis. So in number one, you can see the scales or the crust on the around the lashes, and then in two, you can see the dilated blood vessels. Okay, and again here you can see the this let's say pale, slightly pale rounded area, and at the tip of the row, you can see the let's say the meibomian gland plugging with its secretion itself, with the oily secretion. This is another picture of the this part, the picture to the left. This is mainly the anterior blepharitis, and again here it's involved both the anterior and the posterior lid margin. Another picture, and it's clearly here on the picture on the left, you can see the oily secretions which is blocking the meibomian gland orifices. This is part of the meibomian gland dysfunction or posterior blepharitis. All of the foamy tear film here, you can see like it's like a foam. It's also coming with the meibomian gland dysfunction or posterior blepharitis. Treatment is depend on if it is anterior or posterior. And for anterior blepharitis, lead hygiene with a cotton bud wetted with bicarbonate solution or diluted baby shampoo usually help to remove the squamous depress from the lash line. Warm compresses also could help. Topical steroids can be also helpful, but definitely we should avoid the chronic use of these, let's say, topical eyedrops due to the risk of complication like cataract and increased intraocular pressure. Antibiotics, sometimes we need it mainly for the anterior blepharitis, either topical or systemic topical, like either chloramphenicol, ofloxacin, and difusidic acid. Systemic treatment like oral azithromycin sometimes help with the anterior blepharitis. Definitely, as I said, both of them, the anterior and the posterior blepharitis, can cause abnormal or unstable tear film, and mostly we need an artificial tears. For posterior blepharitis, again, here it's mainly the meibomian gland dysfunction. So hot compresses with massage to express the, let's say, secretions out of these glands will help with the hot bathing. Warm compresses, and sometimes the meibomian gland function could be improved with oral tetracycline or erythromycin in children. Again, as I said, it will be a cause of a dry eye, so definitely we need some sort of artificial eye drops. Antibiotic, like either topical or systemic, as I said, could help also if there is some sort of staphylococcal infection. Talking about the, let's say, benign eyelid masses, so there's many, let's say, types, but the main or the most common types, it will be the calasion, molluscum contagiosum, cysts, either sebaceous or the cyst of Zayas, cyst of Mohl, squamous cell papilloma, xanthelasma, nevus, or keratoacanthoma, which is, to be honest, it's a pre-malignant disease. It's not a very benign, so we'll talk about that later. So calasion, what's the calasion? Calasion is just we can consider it as tarsal plate granuloma, or it's just a blocked, swollen meibomian gland, and usually it's painless swelling, causing painless swelling due to the obstruction of the meibomian gland. Presentation, unsighted lid swelling, usually resolved within a few months with a hot compresses and good massage, but if not, definitely we need to have it removed, or let's say incision and curettage of the meibomian gland itself. This is the calasion, and you can see the unsightly swelling here in the lower lid. And if you will concentrate a little bit more, you can see the pale, slightly elevated opening here of the meibomian gland orifice. Another, let's say, lid masses, which is the internal and external hordeolum. The internal hordeolum, it's an abscess within the meibomian gland, so usually it's painful, require antibiotic treatment due to the infection, and may need, let's say, incision and curettage. External hordeolum, it's, we call it the style, and it's the infection of the lash follicle, so it's a lash follicle abscess, and usually treated with removal of the lash itself and application of warm compresses with topical and sometimes systemic antibiotic. This is the internal hordeolum. So this is infected meibomian gland or meibomian gland abscess. And here, sorry. And this is a style, which is the infected hair follicle or lash follicle. Molluscum contagiosum, I think we mentioned that before. It's a complicated lesion found usually on the margin, caused by pox virus, and usually causing follicular conjunctivitis at the same eye. It could be multiple lesions. Treatment definitely with excision. this is the, sorry, this is the molluscum contagion. Another cyst, so there is many, as I said, which is could be a sebaceous cyst, which is usually opaque, painless, and may be removed for cosmetic causes. Cyst of mold, this is just a sweaty gland obstruction, which gives a small translucent mass. Cyst of Zeyas, this is an also opaque cyst due to obstruction of accessory sebaceous glands. As I said, all of these cysts are benign, and if we have to remove it, this is just for mostly for cosmetic causes. So this is the cyst here to the left of the cyst of Zeyas, cyst of mold, and this is also another cyst of mold. This is a sebaceous cyst. Squamous cell papilloma, most common type of it, it's a frond-like lesion with a fibrovascular core and thickened squamous epithelium. Usually it's asymptomatic, but treatment if needed with excision and cautery of the base. So this is the squamous cell papilloma. Xanthelasma, it's a lipid-containing lesions, usually bilaterally, could affect the upper or the lower eyelid, and it may be associated with hypercholesterolemia, may be excised for cosmetic causes surgically, or we can also use argon laser to get rid of these lesions. But we have to check the serum lipids for the patient and rule out underlying as it hyperlipidemia. This is the xanthelasma, you can see it here. And there is another one, and here you can see another one. This is another picture for the xanthelasma, which is clear here, affecting the upper and the lower eyelid. As say, treatment either surgical removal or argon laser could be used also. Nevus, or mole, or khal, or shamel. This is mainly from the melanocytes. And the nevus in the lights could be pigmented or non-pigmented, and usually we don't have to treat unless it's for cosmetic, as I said, causes. Keratocantoma, as I said, it's not a very benign lesion. It's a we could consider it as a pre-malignant lesion. It's a fast-growing lesion with central crater filled with keratin. It usually passes into two stages, a fast growing phase, then a stationary stage. Histopathologically, it's considered part of the spectrum of the squamous cell carcinoma. It's a premalignant lesion. Treatment, it's a mandatory. You have to do the total excision and send the lesion for histopathology, as I say, to rule out underlying, let's say, new plastic changes. Other options than the excision and the surgical treatment, sometimes we could use radiotherapy or cryotherapy and even 5-fluorouracil. This is the picture of the keratoacanthoma. Malignant tumors, again, there's a lot of lesions, but the main four, let's say, malignant tumors of the eyelid, the most common is the basal cell carcinoma, then squamous carcinoma, sebaceous gland carcinoma, and malignant melanoma. We'll concentrate mainly on the first two of these tumors. So basal cell carcinoma, this is the most common malignant tumor in the human. And the lid basal cell carcinoma accounts for around 10% of the whole basal cell carcinoma, but it's also account for 90% malignancies of the lid itself. So the most common lid malignancy is the basal cell carcinoma. So it's a slow growing, locally invasive tumor and non-metastatic lesion. Presentation, usually with a painless lesion of the mainly the lower eyelid, usually involve the lower eyelid more than the upper, and it could be of nodular type, sclerosing type, or ulcerative, what we call the rodent ulcer, with a pale, pearly margin, and definitely you need a high index of suspicion with these lesions. So this is the three main types of the basal cell carcinoma. This is the nodular type, and this is the sclerosing type. You can see it flat in the lid margin here, okay? And this is the ulcerative type, or the rodent ulcer. So management depends on the location, the size, and the depth of the lesion. So, but mainly it's some surgical treatment, excisional biopsy, or sometimes use the frozen section. Cryotherapy, radiotherapy are other, let's say, options. Prognosis in general is very good unless there is deep invasion, and mainly in the medial canthal area. Squamous cell carcinoma, this is a less common tumor than the basal cell carcinoma, but it's more malignant. It can metastasize to lymph nodes. It can be de novo or from a pre-malignant lesion. Presentation usually with a nodular tab or scaly patch. UV exposure is a risk factor, which is also a risk factor for the basal cell carcinoma and for the keratoacanthoma. Treatment of squamous cell carcinoma, again, with excision with a healthy margin and histopathology. This is just a picture of the squamous cell carcinoma. Talking about the eyelashes abnormality, in the first few pictures we saw the normal position of the lashes, which is lined in the anterior part of the lid margin or the anterior lamella, and it's usually directed away from the globe, away from the eyepole. In trichiasis, which is one of the very common, let's say, lash abnormalities, we can see an abnormally backward directed eyelashes. It could be primary or secondary due to cicatrization or inflammation of the lid margin, especially in trachoma and blepharitis. The problem with the trichiasis, because of this abnormal backward direction, it will can cause or usually cause continuous rubbing of the cornea, and it may end with, let's say, either complication like corneal abrasion, ulcer, and even corneal opacity. The treatment, temporary treatment with epilation, but this usually will, the lash itself will regrow within 6 weeks, okay? But we can use the Harman laser and electrolysis or surgical treatment to permanently treat the trichiasis. This is, if you can see the lashes here, so it's abnormally directed toward the cornea. Another, let's say, picture, and sorry, so this is abnormally directed lashes, and you can see start to have the epithelial defect in the lower part of the cornea here, and even scarring in the lower part. Another, let's say, eyelash abnormality, which is the dystichiasis. This could be a congenital or acquired. The difference between the trichiasis and dystichiasis, here there's an abnormal differentiation of the primary epithelial germ cells into a pilospacious unit. So the origin here of these abnormal lashes, it's abnormal. So usually you can see that from the posterior lamella. So there is abnormal differentiation of the, let's say, germ cells to produce a lash instead of a, let's say, sebaceous gland. So this is the dystichiasis. So it's a lash with abnormal origin. Again, treatment could be with, if it is localized, and if you can be treated either with laser or electrolysis, and sometimes surgical treatment to correct the position of the eyelid margin will be needed. Trichomygary, this is just an excessive eyelash growth, and if we'll speak later about the anti-glaucoma, so all these can cause a little bit overgrowth of the lashes and even darkening of the lashes. So trichomygary, it's excessive eyelash growth. Medarosis, This is just a decrease in the number of lashes, and most common cause for this is a chronic blepharitis, which is the chronic inflammation of the lid margin. Scoliosis, it's a premature whitening of the lashes and the eyebrow. And thank you very much for your attention.